So I welcome again all the sadhaka, pursuers of knowledge. And because of you, I have got this opportunity to study once again and get some new insights from Yoga Vasishtha. I'm really happy. So now we have now come to the third day of this series. And today we have very beautiful discussion. In nutshell, you have world experience, we'll be discussing further, appearances are illusion, vital breath and mind relation, consciousness, individual and the supreme. Now, the first one, you see here, consciousness, that is repeatedly described and propounded in our Yoga Vasishtha. The ultimate reality is nothing but consciousness. This we all have to accept and understand. Though consciousness has not been properly investigated by the Western scientists or psychologists also, but we don't bother about them. Whatever is useful for us, that we have to pursue. And this consciousness is that which is responsible for all the functions in the body. The senses, the vital breath, the mind, and even intellect and ego principle. So all these, according to Indian philosophy, are inert. So they cannot function on their own. But these appear like ripples on the surface of water because of the consciousness. So this consciousness is the source behind all activities. This is the first thing. And that's why from consciousness only the mind appears, and from consciousness only the matter also appears. Now, matter and mind, these appear to be two different entities. But I have given deliberately the word Yoga Vasishtha Advaita. And the word Advaita means singleness, singularity, or non-dualism. You can take any word, but actually Advaita. So for this we have to understand Dvaita. The word comes from Dvi. Dvi plus Ita. Dvita. Then with the suffix it becomes Dvaita. Dvaita means all division, all polarity, all duals. It is Dvaita. And all the while in the Vedas, in the Brahmana Granthas, in the Upanishads, and even in Yoga Vasishtha, these seers have been trying to throw some light on the ultimate reality of this universe, ultimate. So actually, it doesn't appear. But because of that, everything appears. That is the irony of that. And that is known as undivided, non-dual. And so actually, there is no polarity. So that particular reality is known as Advaita. Dvaita means two, and Advaita means single. And what are the two? And here we find mind and matter, because mind is the perceiver, matter is the perceived. So if these two are there, then Dvaita comes. Many people believe that Dvaita is real, but even the particle physics and quantum physics, they actually deny. They say if you say that both are real, then you don't know proper science. They say, not myself, not even Yoga Vasishtha, but even the modern scientists say that if you think that two things exist separately, then you are mistaken. Because mind and matter is actually one, it is matter only. Then consciousness, does it cause matter? So in what way it causes? That's very important, pertinent question. And Einstein, somewhere he has been quoted to have stated this: we cannot understand theoretically why matter should appear as discrete electrical particles. So yesterday we had seen, right from the Planck era throughout, we have gone to the nucleosynthesis era, and then further final particle age, then atom age, then the final galaxy formation, etc. And if somebody looks at the galaxies and all the bodies in the galaxies and says duality is real, then the scientist also will laugh at him and say that actually all the galaxies, if you look into this, the true nature of this matter, you will understand that they're all atoms, and atom further the particles, and further you find most of the abundant element in the universe is hydrogen, and further if you look into that, so you find quarks, because proton and neutron, neutrinos are there, and further if you look into that, only fields you find, and that also not in the beginning initial stage, because in the initial stage there was no electron was also not formed, they say, and that's why hydrogen was the element which actually doesn't have any electron. So that electron was created later, and then electromagnetic field was created. So that's why if you say that matter is different from consciousness and the effect is different from the cause, you are mistaken, because the cause is manifesting itself as effect. So effect is nothing but its own manifestation, and that's why the duality is only an appearance and everything is consciousness. And that consciousness is repeatedly stated in the Yoga Vasishta as Brahman. Brahma is the proper word used for that. See, in the Greek philosophy also they used, Democritus used the word atom, meaning indivisible, unbroken, that which cannot break further into further parts. But later the same atom was proved to have parts also, like nucleus, the electron outer shell moving around, all this. So your understanding of a particular reality and naming that particular reality is proved to be false, like atom. So we have given a Brahman, so that particular word carries all that great idea behind. It is undivided, it is unchangeable, and these are the words exactly the scientists use for the primordial force also. It is unchangeable, undivided. So in that sense, Vasishtha Maharshi, or maybe any other seer who might have composed the text, he had that great vision, that great understanding of the universe in and out. So that real great contribution of that soul. And this consciousness, and it is nothing but Advaita, though we draw a cause and effect relation between all these, actually we don't find anything, because Advaita means undivided energy being the sole reality. And that reality is known as Advaita Advitiya. And Yoga Vasishtha does not endorse any other system of philosophy than only Advaita. Yoga Vasishtha does not find any compromise, and it absolutely accepts and expounds only Advaita Advaita. And this Advaita is known as Kevala Advaita of Shankaracharya. And that Shankaracharya also got it from his teacher, Govinda Bhagavat Pada. He got that sacred knowledge from his teacher, Gaudapada. And that Gaudapada got it from Shuka Maharshi. He got it from Vyasa. He got it from further to Vasishtha. So, and Vasishtha got it from Narayana. So that's what the tradition says. So this is the sacred tradition of Advaita. And in Yoga Vasishtha, we find a semblance of the same sacred knowledge. As the famous equation of Einstein goes, E is equal to mc square. So it's actually, even Newton, in the classical physics of Newton, we find the matter-mind or the dualities. So he never tried to compare or combine these two. But after maybe 1905 to 1910, when Einstein published the two articles, like Special Theory of Relativity, General Theory of Relativity, then people started appreciating the concept that matter is energy, energy is matter. It's actually, there is only one. Even Nikola Tesla, when he had discussions with Vivekananda, so he had also very strongly supported Vivekananda's idea, because when the discussion was taking place, it is said that Einstein, Max Planck, they were all school children. Actually, they didn't have any idea. But Vivekananda discussed such things with Nikola Tesla, and Tesla had made wonderful theories out of that. Whatever it is, world, matter, mind. So what we have been understanding so far is, we have a mind and outside matter, and the world consists of these two. So therefore, world means matter, and the perceiving agent is mind. So there is a cycle that again and again, the mind will be creating these things, and further impressions are created, and further mind is created. Now, mind, as I told you several times, it is abstract. In all the philosophical systems, they say that mind is not something tangible or not a physical matter. It is only abstract. But still, it is a product of nature, they believed. And the problem is, the external world is not found to be unreal. In Advaita, though the cycle is very clear, the thing is, the external world, what is the status of this world in the Advaita of Shankaracharya or Yoga Vasishtha? So one may tend to say that actually it is totally negated because mithya, maya. But here I would like to correct it. I would like to add something to that. That maya is, as I told you, not negative. It is actually negatively positive energy of the same Supreme Consciousness. So the way it functions is maya. The way it functions, we cannot easily understand that. That's why it is known as maya. And second thing is, if you change the position of these two letters, ma, ya, if you change ya, ma, ya, it is actually a reflective pronoun. Ya, that which is ma, is negated. That means actually it is a negatively positive energy, that this maya, whatever it produces, that is negated later. So it produces man, it produces the world, it produces everything, all the experiences, which is negated later. That's why the cause of all such experience is known as maya or yama. And that's why in the Vedanta philosophy, in Yoga Vasishtha, the external world is not found to be unreal. They never say that it is unreal, but they say it is not permanent. We should understand the difference. Something is unreal if it is not at all available, but the world is a matter of experience. So how can you deny? No, we don't deny that, but we say that it doesn't have any final permanent existence. It is only temporary. Then what is permanent? The cause is permanent, the Brahman or the consciousness is permanent, and it only pervades in all the three divisions of time, whereas the world, with all its changing phenomena, it appears like something projected on the screen. See, so many slides in the animation also, so many slides are prepared and they are moved with a speed, and actually they create an impression that something is going on in continuity. But actually there is no continuity at all. If something happens to the projector, or if slows down, you find there something is wrong with the thing projected on the screen also. Similarly, in the universe also, though everything appears to be in perfect coordination and perfect continuity, it's actually, there is no continuity at all, because everything is only knit together. Everything is put in a particular channel. And for this, physics uses the word entropy. See, there is a kind of disorderness, but we are not aware of that. We find only the whether there are galaxies, all this. See, everything is in order, we find. But maya produces that for some time. And I repeat, for some time. and whatever is projected for some time is known as mithya maya. So this word should be properly understood so as to appreciate that. But the real is found to be not external. That's the problem. What Advaita wants to say, that whatever is appearing, this world, is not unreal. But you are engrossed in that. You are carried away by this external world. But the real, the problem is it is not external. Therefore, this leads to the Barbara logic, like A is equal to B, B is equal to C, therefore A is equal to C. Here also, external world is not real, real is not external, therefore, so you get the idea clear. Therefore, external world is actually not real. Because real is not external. Real, that means that which is in all three divisions of time, past, present, future, that is not external. External refers to whatever is cognized, grasped, perceived with the help of senses and other means also. But the real is not really grasped with the help of any external apparatus or means, methods. So this idea is actually the crux of Vedanta, Advaita Vedanta. It says, we every day we observe the world, we see the things around, the objects, matter, individuals, life, different ways. Life in the form of trees, plants, life, animals, birds, insects, everything we are watching. But you understand, these are all cells. These are all atoms. And all the cells come together, all the atoms come together to form bodies, like the galaxies. Then, what is behind? So actually, this has troubled scientists and philosophers alike, and they have their own method of dealing with the subject. So here you find that the Advaita Vedanta says, if you look deep into the nature of these, you further get into the absolute stage of energy. There is nothing beyond energy. That is very important here. Energy. And that energy, though we say energy has potential, kinetic form, etc., but I tell you, we are referring to a different kind of energy, not physical, but consciousness. So though the word is used for this consciousness, we should understand that consciousness as Brahman is the true energy, and physical energy is only a manifestation of that, not real. Even the sun, the stars, the fire, whether it is thermal or hydroelectric, whatever it is, even water is electric. So all these are only manifestation of that, that we should appreciate. And in this process, we see this creation, all the while we ask, creation, is it real or apparent? Because Shastra says it is apparent creation, and our senses say it is real, because yesterday also we had a class and today also we are having a class, so it should be real. And Yoga Vasishtha says it is like a dream, and in a dream you may get two dreams. So the thing is continuing. So life is a long dream. That's what Yoga Vasishtha says. And in this particular one, you see the nature, how does it function? See, how it functions, see, the mirage there. And the nature, as if driven by a very intelligent principle, it is actually showing itself. And it is also making comedy of that. How? You may say coincidence. Yes, it is coincidence, okay? But there is something called illusion in the universe, and it is part of nature. And I remember that Einstein's famous theory was later proved by his student, just because of the illusion that time travels in a curvy line also. That was Einstein's theory, and he proved later. Initially, they rejected and they ridiculed also, saying that Einstein nowadays makes theories which are unintelligible and nonsense. But later it was proved when there was a solar eclipse, and his student, I remember maybe Eddington, that image It's not real, but appears. And Yoga Vasishtha uses the Pratibimba word for image and uses the same for Jivatma also. That means whoever is talking now, whoever is listening, whoever is understanding, he is Jivatma, Jiv. And according to Yoga Vasishtha, he is only a Pratibimba, a replica of the Brahman. So there you see that mirage or the other one, they are only appearances. Now, what is the difference between apparent and real? One is appearance and other is real. What is the difference? In Sanskrit, we use the word parinama for change. That means when the characteristics of a particular object really change, like the milk changing to curd. So this is actually change. And for that, we have the parinama. But our science does not support this theory. In the universe, nothing can change permanently. It's only vivarta, means appearing as if it has changed. See, when water becomes ice, people may say it is parinama of water. But the person who really knows the thing, he says it is only vivarta. That means it has changed its state, not the characteristics. So it is this vivarta, the theory that the Yoga Vasishtha supports. What is vivarta? Vivarta means illusion or false appearance. In you can take the famous example that something is there, we are mistaking that for some other thing. It is vivarta. Actually, nothing has happened. Everything has happened in the mind, not outside. No rope changes itself into a snake. Even when magician changes or seems to change everything, nothing changes. It's only the perceiver's mind that changes. So we have the illusions and hallucinations. Nothing changes. So when the magician all of a sudden pulls out a pigeon from his hat, actually, he cannot create pigeons from space. No. Similarly, no flowers from space. It's only appearance, illusion. And here also, everything is, everything in the world seems to change. But Yoga Vasishtha says they are actually not changing. That is an illusion. One thing is appearing differently, and we are unable to understand the base of that, and we are carried away by the appearances. And you know, the appearances, like the words, are deceptive. See, the appearances are deceptive, the words are also so. And that's why the less number of words you use in Vedanta, the clearer you will be, they say. Because more words, more confusion. And more in the moments of meditation, more clarity you will gain. That's what Yoga Vasishtha also says. But now, we don't sit in meditation later. And here you find why appearances are illusion. First thing is that the world which we are in and have been observing, that world is a game of colors, sounds and shapes. What we look around, only colors, sounds and shapes. You may say, blind people, dumb people, they don't have any understanding of this. But dumb person can hear sounds, deaf person can feel the shapes, blind person also can feel shapes, and others can see the colors also. So this way it is all actually colors, sounds and shapes for a particular object. So the world consists of matter in the form of objects, and these are nothing but colors, sounds and shapes. And here all these are nothing but the game of electrons. And for the taste, for example, sour taste, etc., so protons, nothing but these. But we give some words to them and understand that they are real and different. So we have galaxy of terms, galaxy of categories to deal with, to classify, to analyze further. But natural sciences do not support this. They say it's only a game of colors and sounds. And sense universe, that means whatever we observe with the help of our senses, is also a play of senses and nerves. Yeah, because the sense nerves, they reach to the top of this, the end of the skin, the receptors, and the skin being a good receptor that responds to the external the condition, and whatever heat, cold, whatever it is, it responds and it passes on this information to the brain, and the brain, which actually has all these thalamus and hypothalamus, pituitary, pineal, so all these are chemical actually, so they in a perfect coordination try to keep the body unhurt, safe, healthy. For that they give instructions to the glands, various glands like the thyroid, parathyroid here in the neck, and that means throat, and below thymus, and below you have pancreas, and on kidneys also you have two glands. So this actually hypothalamus, when it stimulates it, when it sends signal, so the secretion of hormones starts, and it's actually all our responses are based on this senses and nerves, a false show kept up by the jugglery of Maya, nothing but mind and nerves. So who has created these nerves and who has instructed them? You be artery and you be vein, you are heart and your duty is this, lungs, and there also pancreas, insulin, and there the beta cells, they actually produce the insulin and glucose, glycogen. So all this process, it's actually very perfect order. Somebody is dictating, somebody has already dictated, your duty is this, you be in the body till your last breath, and everything is going on well. So it is all Maya, Yoga Vasishtha says. And now the teaching of Vasishtha is, see, you clearly see that this world is a mere play of nerves. I have used the word nerves, though Yoga Vasishtha doesn't use the word, but play of nerves means the indriya, senses. See, we have indriya, like eyes, indriya, the sense of seeing, sense of hearing, sense of smell, sense of taste, sense of touch. These are actually five senses, and the senses are nothing but nerves, and various nerves, nerve ends are there in different parts of body, and we get different knowledge. That means we receive the external world with the help of nerves, and Yoga Vasishtha says that this is nothing but indriya maya. So this is created by indriyas. And Rama, you understand that this universe of opposites is illusory. That means whether it is happiness or gloom, glee or gloom, or cold or heat, or any other dualities, they actually, that world is illusory. That means you balance your mind and you give firm in your understanding that no dualities in the universe. And it is direct teaching to Ramachandra, Sri Ramachandra. And Sri Ramachandra, he had in totality taken the teaching, and he remained in that state. Then only, till his last moment of leaving this body, he was in that poised state, equilibrium, absolute psychological balance. He was in that. So this teaching is very important, that the universe of opposites is illusory. And here, and we depend upon these nerves and senses for our happiness. Ultimately, happiness is, though temporary, is more sought after, and that depends on our senses. And lung capacity, now we come to the prana, because the Yoga Vasishtha starts with that and very repeatedly advocates the theory of prana spanda, and it says there is a very good harmony between these two, your the vital breath and the mind. It says you stop either, the other is already stopped. That means if you have full control on your vital breath, the pranayama, then mind also comes into your control. Or with the help of any other method, if you can stop your mind, then vital breath is also in your control. That's why sometimes it so happens that in deep meditation, when we sit, actually we forget ourselves, our breathing also stops for some time. And that's why it is stated that the Vedic seers and others, they used to live for hundreds of years, because that they can elongate, prolong their life also. Now, when we try to understand this pranayama, why Yoga Vasishtha has very strongly recommended the prana and pranayama, we understand in modern terms, lung capacity. We have the inner organ called lung, and 6 liters of air it can take. But what is air after all? So it is nothing but water vapor, oxygen, nitrogen, carbon dioxide, and sometimes dust and smoke also. All this enters through our nostrils into the through the esophagus, pharynx, and below the bronchi, so lungs. And the lungs have to filter this air so that oxygen is taken, or the filtering process itself is oxygenating that. So 20% oxygen, if we can take every day, it's normal. Some people say 100% oxygen, so we will be very, very strong and will become Superman. But science says you cannot take 100% oxygen, and if anybody takes, or if it is pumped inside, then it will be very toxic and harmful. The person may die. Side effects are there. Only 21% is normal. So a gas exchange that takes place in the millions of alveoli in the lungs and the capillaries. So inhaled oxygen moves from the alveoli to the blood in the capillaries, and carbon dioxide that moves from the blood to the air in the alveoli. So it is actually exchange of gases that takes in the lungs, and then oxygenated blood through the arteries, it reaches all cells, and the cells get actually energized. So this is the secret, that pranayama, when we are practicing pranayama, actually we are supplying oxygen. But that oxygen, the very important ingredient of the universe, not in the sense of matter, because in the formation of matter, oxygen is not that important. Carbon dioxide and hydrogen, they are very important. But when it comes to living organisms, so there is the importance of this oxygen. So in the pranayama, actually we are dealing with this oxygen. And Yoga Vasishtha says, this proper breathing technique that actually that supplies proper amount of oxygen to the body, and as a result, now I'll show you, as a result, you see immediately next, what happens in the body? The brain requires a constant supply of oxygen and glucose. This is a very popular thing, that in order to function properly, the brain requires two things: regular supply of oxygen and glucose. So the blood supplies these two. And as we know, 15% of the heart capacity, the pumping capacity, 15% of the blood is required for the brain. So that goes up anti-gravity. And naturally, the blood carries oxygen and glucose. Now what happens? Why pranayama affects our thinking? Pranayama affects our intelligence. The thing is, without enough oxygen or with low blood oxygen levels, the brain has trouble signaling where to send blood to oxygen-hungry muscles and tissues. So it gets confused, because there are muscles and tissues, because there must be oxygen debt in the muscles. so they are in need of that. But the brain is in a confused state where to supply, because signaling process is damaged. So that's why, in order to give proper signals, brain requires oxygen. And oxygen is supplied to the lungs through pranayama. So an oxygen boost is important. That boost can allow the cells to manufacture more energy, because each cell is capable of producing energy. They take the glucose from the blood, and they actually they release the energy. But sometimes it so happens that in diabetes, the cells, they do not either receive the glucose, or the insulin itself is not produced. Therefore, the glycogen and glucose process itself is stopped. That is the problem. So when we practice regular pranayama, there is proper oxygen boost, and this added energy allows the brain to repair, regenerate, and function better. You understand? This is actually the source of all intelligence. So the more you practice pranayama in a very proper manner, so you will have a very balanced mind, calmness, and increased intelligence levels, and it can function better. So that's why nowadays this is recommended even to the patients. And in deep sleep also, you find this, like deep meditation, in deep sleep also you find that the breathing patterns, they change and they get regulated automatically. That's why we get all calmness within. And in this process, what happens when we puraka, we say, that means inhaling. So when we inhale, so that oxygen, the filtering oxygen is over, and oxygen is supplied to the blood, into the blood, and the blood takes this to all the cells, and all the cells are invigorated, and now the energy is released, fine. And in this process, contraction of the diaphragm sends a message to the brain to release dopamine. This is the hormone stated to be the hormone of happiness, the positive in the brain. And people do several things to get this dopamine secretion. Some people go for shopping also very frequently. Some people read books. Some people chat with friends. Some people listen to good music. Some people just sleep only for this dopamine. And this is in the brain along with other chemicals. But the release of this particular one is very important, because it gives a calming effect and a positive effect, that everything is, all is well, all is well. So this gives that. And when you do regular pranayama, Yoga Vasishtha says, you find manaf prasannata. It's nothing but calming of mind, which is again supported by modern science. Dopamine also enhances mood and acts as a pain reliever. This is very important. So that's why when a person is in deep pain, if he very in a controlled manner practices pranayama, then he can goad his senses also. He can teach his senses to calm down. The effects of deep breathing for 5 to 20 minutes have shown an increase in alpha waves in the brain. Again, alpha, delta, so these are the brain waves. And when there are the alpha waves at 5 minutes, so that remains unchanged until the end of the 20 minutes. But an increase on theta power, both 15 to 20 minutes. So actually, meditation and pranayama, that they increase the alpha waves, proved. And because of that, a person feels some quietness inside, and actually all health is rooted in this. Alpha is the power of now, being here in the present. It is actually resting state for the brain. So alpha waves aid overall mental coordination, calmness, alertness, mind body integration, and learning. So all these faculties are enhanced. So you find a kind of development in all these faculties with the regular practice of pranayama. And that's why Yoga Vasishtha very repeatedly says in all the 6 chapters, Rama, prana is the source of all energy. It is the source of all prajna because of this particular aspect. And vital breath and mind, the relation is the rhythm of breathing creates electrical activity in the brain. Yeah, this is very important. Because I told you yesterday also that neuron supply is very important. The neurons in the brain is actually through dendrites, they pass on mild electric charge to the next neuron, and thus the information is passed, the sense is passed. So all instructions are passed on to the next, and the body is functioning in a very coordinated manner. And this electrical activity that is created in the brain with the help of rhythmic breathing pattern. That means gradually inhaling, just holding for a few seconds and exhaling. Again exhaling, holding breath and inhaling. So this is actually a very balanced rhythmic breathing pattern. And with this, we find an effect in the brain that enhances emotional judgments and memory recall. Individuals also were more likely to remember an object if they encountered it on the inhaled breath. So naturally, when you inhale, so you can remember. And while exhaling, mind is in a relaxed mood, it cannot remember. So the more oxygen you supply to the brain, so more intelligent you will be. So this I have tried to show in this one. And yeah, so now we come to the important topics of Yoga Vasishtha, that we are all belonging to the first one, that is individual consciousness, the energy conditioned by ego, intellect and mind. So yesterday also we had discussed about this. Conditioned soul is jiva. What are the conditions? Time and space are the conditions for all, but for jiva, ego, intellect and thoughts, actually these are the conditions. When the consciousness is conditioned by these, it is jiva. When it is not conditioned, it is Paramatma. Then you may say, then how can the consciousness think to create? Because creation is a result of that. So there, it is not controlled by mind. It controls the mind. So the consciousness is the master of mind. So yesterday, last slide also, you see, master of mind is the consciousness. So this individual consciousness is known in Indian philosophy as Jiva, and Jiva is actually one who resides in a body for some time and experiences whatever is ordained for them. That's all. Jiva is that consciousness. And this is also a relative state, because in deep meditation or in the state of deep sleep, we have no emotions, no experiences, nothing. Then a person may say, yes, we were not there. Okay, if we were not there, after waking up, who is awakened and who connects with the universe? Who connects with the previous relations, all that? Who recollects? Something must be there. And if somebody says it is created new, afresh, then it should not recollect. It should only connect, that's all. But it recollects. That means whatever happened before getting into deep sleep and whatever is happening after coming out of that state. So the particular gap seems to be complete absence of everything, but our Yoga Vasishtha says it is not absolute absence of everything. There was this individual consciousness as energy, and because of that only the body was alive. So that consciousness is in the deep sleep, is in the deep meditative state, and when it comes back, it reconnects. But it sometimes it so happens that after deep meditations, the mind will not be very active, that it will not connect with the world as it used to do before. Many a times in the lives of many saints, it happened that the more he practiced meditation, deep state of contemplation, and the moment he came out of that, so the person has changed, that jiva has changed. Valmiki Maharshi is a beautiful example of that. A thief, but once he sat in meditation and maybe so many years he was in that state, and when he opened his eyes, he forgot all his previous life, only knew Valmiki afresh. Several other examples are there. Even Sadashiva Brahmendra Saraswati in Tamil Nadu, Raman Maharshi. So all these, because it actually opens up the third eye, and the individual consciousness is jiva, and it is nothing but a semblance of the supreme consciousness. Why semblance? So the Yogava sister uses the word pratibimba, the image. How? See, the sun getting reflected in the waters, you find a reflection of sun in the water, of whatever kind it may be. The water may be pure or impure, whatever it may be, but the sun gets reflected. And Yoga Vasishtha says, the supreme consciousness, when it actually manifests in all the bodies like jiva, and these are like the water reservoirs, the bodies, and in so many water reservoirs, the sun gets reflected. Similarly, the supreme consciousness also gets reflected. But the supreme consciousness, when it is reflected as individual consciousness, is not contaminated or does not get impure by the impurities of matter. Just like the sun's reflection is not contaminated by the water. So here uses the word, the consciousness in the body is not different from the supreme consciousness. The body is the container for some time. And you may say that, okay, if the body is the container, I'll drop this body, I'll committing suicide or something, then I will be liberated. It says no. Because if you forcibly give up this body, your impressions will carry you to another body. Because body is nothing but creation of mind, the impressions. So the vasana will take us to another body. That is the problem. So individual consciousness, in the terms of Yoga Vasishtha, is nothing but the reflection of supreme consciousness, unaffected by the matter. And supreme consciousness, this is the cosmic energy. Yeah, this is very important. Supreme consciousness is that which is manifesting itself in crores of bodies, fish, insects, microbes, bacteria, virus, so many, amoeba, fungi, so many. You cannot count them. So many species, known and unknown. And through all this, some energy is flowing, and some energy is actually holding those bodies. And for some time, the bodies will be appearing as alive. And that energy is known as supreme consciousness. It is responsible for all the creation and sustenance and even dissolution of the world, and it is unconditioned. So in the Upanishads and Yoga Vasishtha, the same thing is repeated, that whatever causes the world appearance, whatever makes it appear for some time, and whatever takes it back within, that is supreme consciousness. So let us try to understand this way. A small seed has the potential of energy. Any tree you take, small seed, but when it is sown with the help of all the other factors, it starts expressing itself in the form of a small plant, then tree, then all the leaves and flowers and fruits, everything. But whatever is appearing now was in that particular seed, in a seed form, बीज रूप विषय एंड देयर मस्ट बी सम एनर्जी लेटेंट एनर्जी विच इज वेरी डोमिनेंट विच इज वेरी स्ट्रांग बट इट इज एक्चुअली वेटिंग फॉर राइट मूवमेंट दैट्स ऑल एंड व्हेन इट गेट्स राइट मूवमेंट इट स्टार्ट्स एक्सप्रेसिंग इटसेल्फ एंड आफ्टर सम टाइम व्हाट हैपेंस देन वी गो टू द सस्टेनेंस दैट मीन्स फॉर सम टाइम देयर विल बी responding to the external stimuli in the form of life for some time. Okay, the tree is there, beautiful, all flowers, leaves, everything, and you have been observing a very small leaf, then green, a very live, beautiful green. Then after a few days you have seen the leaves have become, have turned into yellow and they have fallen down. And what happened then? That's actually chemical change, but what happened then? Then gradually it has dried up in summer and it has become dust. That's all. So where from has it come and wherein has it merged? So this is the point. Now when you apply the same to the entire universe of galaxies, stars, everything, recently a star was observed to have entered into a black hole. So maybe 450 billion light years or something. But it has been observed. Then who has caused that? How it had entered and what happened to that? So some scientist made a statement that who knows? The Earth may be in a black hole. Who knows? Because you are out of a black hole or within a black hole. You are a tiny human being. You cannot understand with the help of even powerful telescopes also, you cannot understand what is happening beyond the end of some galaxies. Only they have limitation. All the instruments have limitation, the senses and the instruments also. So there is no way of knowing the reality beyond all whatever limited knowledge we can get, we try to get it. So the Supreme Consciousness is that energy which is responsible for this manifestation of the world and the appearance of the world for some time and again the disappearance of the world into it. That is Supreme Consciousness. And that particular Supreme Consciousness has been given names also in our scriptural texts like Rama, Krishna, Vishnu, Narayana. And some people say, why all men? There are women also in the participants. So okay, Durga, Kali, Bhavani, Sita, Lakshmi. So female names are also given. But actually energy is one. It has no gender. Actually, it is only your emotion that you are calling it as mother, father, etc. But otherwise, it is absolute energy. And that is the Supreme Consciousness when it actually gives joy. Giving joy. So this particular phrase can be expressed with the help of the word Rama. Rama. Rama means to enjoy. Rama means that which causes joy, that which makes other people rejoice. So that is known as Rama aspect of Supreme Consciousness. And again Krishna. And in Sanskrit it is said Krishna. That which takes off your miseries and miserable life experience. So that is known as Krishna. And Vishnu is another word for Brahma because it is all pervading. So if we can understand Sanskrit words, we can well appreciate our Indian philosophy also. Then we have, okay, individual consciousness, supreme consciousness. If Dvaita is there, that means if duality is real, then you can never get to the Supreme Consciousness. You are always individual consciousness. Supreme Consciousness will be different from you. But our people, our seers, have given this meditation. And meditation is the process to raise the consciousness from the individual level to the supreme level. That's what Aravinda Ghosh also stated in his Integral Yoga. And even in Savitri, one of his epic poems, he says somewhere, it is human debt to the Almighty. What he wants to say is, we should put on his garb as he puts on him ours. That means when God can take a human form, why not the human take a God form? So it is possible, he says. And for that only, from the infrasentient level, we should raise ourselves to the suprasentient level, that is supreme consciousness, and it is possible, he says. And Yoga Vasishtha very strongly says it is possible through meditation. And meditation has pranayama for its part, the means to raise individual to the level of supreme consciousness by totally emptying the mind. This is very important. It's actually meditation. Somebody asked Lord Buddha, asked him, Dhyan mein kya karna hai? What to do in meditation? Then Lord Buddha replied, don't do anything, it is meditation. But people understand that I should do something. As long as you do something, it is no meditation at all. You actually withdraw all your activities and empty up. The problem is, when we try to empty up, all unnecessary things also crop up. Everything comes in that moment, because we are trying to empty up mind. Then we are aware, whatever is to be emptied, oh, this I have to empty, this I have to empty. So everything faces up. Now, emptying mind is possible with the help of pranayama, and emptying should be practiced gradually. And Bhagavad Gita says, Shanai Shanai Rupaname Buddhya Dhritigrihitaya. Very wonderful statement. It says, gradually you catch hold of your mind, don't get excited, don't get disturbed, and don't entertain. You are entertaining everything. That's why you are entertaining all the thoughts they are entering. So don't let yourself carried away by these thoughts, and that particular second you just feel the calmness and it continues. For that, generally recommended practices in the Shatkarma, Kapalabhati is also good, Brahmari is also good, Bhastrika is also good, and other 8 pranayama methods are there. But if we regularly practice, I tell you, we are bound to experience the high level of consciousness within. So that is emptying the mind. Because we ourselves have allowed all the dust inside through the windows called the senses. We have opened the windows and we have allowed all the dust inside, and we are now crying and shouting, why this dust? And asking somebody to clean it. But when we have allowed, we have to clean. So we need not approach a teacher to clean it up. We should sit in meditation, we should close our eyes, practice pranayama, and we should do it. And for that only, when it is blowing outside, blowing dust, first thing is to close the windows. That means pratyahara. First, you close your senses. Closing senses is not just closing eyes and putting some cotton in the ears. No, it is actually not listening to something, hearing something, seeing something, that state. That is actually pratyahara. And when we are really in that state, even with the practice of Omkara, we can get that. So in that state, gradually a quietude enters in. A quietude. We feel it. And after that, a total pacification of mind. And wonderful. Actually, we don't want to come out. But other people are there in the family, they want us to come out. So we don't want to come out. We want to be in the same state for again, for several minutes, because that is actually the joy of that. And after that, all of a sudden, we enter into dhyana. And when that continues for some time, that dharana becomes dhyana. And when dhyana also continues, that you forget everything, emptying the mind, then it is known as samadhi. So samadhi is that state where there is no observer, where there is no trio called jnata, jnaya, jnana. The triputi is gone. And you or yourself. So that is emptying the mind. And so the means, this particular experience of dhyana or samadhi is a means to raise the individual self to the supreme conscious level. And Patanjali Yoga Darshana says in a sutra, Yoga Vasishtha says that same thing in the shloka. What is that? Ritam bhara tatra prajna. Nirvichara vaisharadye adhyatma prasadaha. That is the sutra used by Patanjali. He has given the formula. He says, when you reach that particular emptied state of mind, then nirvichara vaisharadye. There are no vichara, there are no thoughts. Vaisharadya, and this is the sthiti, vahini. So that is the continuing state, unperturbed by any other. And then it continues, adhyatma prasadaha. So you actually feel inside a great calmness. And as a result, you experience a change in yourself, especially your intelligence. So this is actually raising ourselves to the level of supreme consciousness. That means all of a sudden, as it is shown in the cinema, all of a sudden a cycle revolving, rotating behind our head, and all of a sudden a glow. Okay, there will be an increase in the aura around the body. Protoplasm, some changes there biologically also. But the consciousness especially, that is raised. And more energy. And more energy is more positivity. More positivity is more love, affection, understanding, sympathy, empathy, compassion. All these are the result of the positivity, and the positivity that comes from the deep state of emptying the mind. And that should be separately practiced with the help of Omkara or Pranayama or any mantra also. Because mantra yoga, the subtle form of sound is used as mantra there, which can take us into deeper, subtler state of mind. People say subconscious, is accepting the unconscious, subconscious states. Yeah, it can take us. The mantra, it is actually energy, the sound force. And that wave can take us into that state. And very typically, some of you may have experienced, I don't know, but you can definitely experience that when you are in the perfect state of emptying the mind, then you have taken a mantra, that is sound, any syllable, and you are repeating that, and you find that you are not different from that. So that particular sound throbs somewhere in the throat, somewhere in the heart, somewhere in the navel, and below also. You can experience the throbbing of that particular, that sense. You can sense it. And when that is experienced, actually a great happiness that you can experience inside. So this is the meditation, the effect of meditation, very beautiful. And for that, the entry into liberation is not difficult, but not very easy. For that, the first thing they have advocated is self-control. Self-control. What is self? Here the word self is used for mind and intellect only. Man and buddhi. Self. So self-control, that means we have to school our senses. We have to channelize our emotions. And especially the deciding faculty. The faculty of taking decision, judgment. That should be proper. If we take improper decision, then mind becomes active and mind again starts wavering. So that's why senses, mind and intellect, if you understand the hierarchy, then you can appreciate the word self-control. And this self-control leads to contemplation. Contemplation is remaining inside without any disturbance. Then as a result of that, you experience contentfulness. That is total samadhana, santosha. Patanjali says, santoshad anuttama sukhalabha. That means you feel this contentfulness and you experience great joy within. And for that, you require pious company. Because sangati, they say, the company of other people is very important, because the more you the more you mingle with other people, the more exposed you will be. And other people may not be of the same level. So that's why when they share their ideas, actions, everything, you automatically get motivated or sometimes influenced. And as a result, your mind becomes active. That's why your company should be pious. And luckily, these almost 1.5-2 hours, we are in good company, pious company, because we are not thinking of other things. We are just thinking of all good things stated in our Yoga Vasishta and other scriptures. So this is pious company. If it continues and if it is not disturbed by external other association, then we can that the other results can be guaranteed for us. And in this process, realization is possible through mind control, which is possible through breath control. So for that, study is of two types. Studying something, people generally understand, studying something means reading books. Because I can study only by reading a book. But reading a book is also study. But without that also, you can study the world around. That study is very important. You study, every moment is moment of study. Like Aravinda Ghosh said, every moment is moment of yoga. So here, every moment is moment of study. Swadhyaya. The word used for this is in Sanskrit, Swadhyaya. People generally translate it as self-study. But I prefer to use the word study of self. That is very important. Not sitting alone and reading books and not allowing any other person in your room is not self-study. Self-study means study of the self. That is very important. Who am I? That is a basic problem. So we have to study that. And at the same time, only to find a kind of harmony between the world inside and outside, we should understand the world outside also, otherwise it will disturb us. So only to cajole the world outside, you should know actually how is it made up of, what are the constituent factors of that, and for what purpose it is created, and what is its true nature. So if you study the world outside in this way, it will not disturb you further. Because generally disturbances means outside world creating some impressions in the form of inside world, and both disturbing. That means not allowing me to sit in a particular state of meditation. That is the problem. And here, Swadhyaya, Yoga Vasishta uses the word Swadhyaya. That means Swa is Atma. Swa means Atma. Swa into one's own self. Adhi Aya. Swa Adhi Aya. Three components are there. Swa Adhi Aya. All put together Swadhyaya. Swa means one's own self. Adhi means inside. Aya means getting. So all put together, getting into one's own self. That is self-study or study of self, that is Swadhyaya. Receiving knowledge from various sources. From, like in the Bhagavata you find Avadhuta accepting 24 as his teachers. So he knew, he learned several things from 24 things. Like a bird, a tree, from everything he had learned something. And even in this Upanishad, Chandogya, you find an episode that one Upakosala. So his teacher teaches something, but before the completion of his study only, the teacher had to go somewhere. He sets on a journey, and that particular period he was alone. The student was alone. The student was in the sacrificial hall, cleaning it up and just resting there, and getting pity for that boy. The sacrificial fires only teach all the necessary knowledge. and the boy learns everything, and when the teacher returns and asks, "Are you seem to be wise? What happened? Who taught you all these things?" Then he says, "In your absence, all this sacrificial fire, this atmosphere only taught me everything." So that all depends on your disposition, how you dispose yourself. So everything can become a teacher, and you can receive knowledge from everything. Contemplation, we had discussed. Realization is the result of contemplation, not immediate, but may take several years also, several births also. That is there. And for that, the Upanishadic ideology recommends a process. First, you shravana, you listen to, you hear. Because you have attended this Yoga Vasishta class, you may have got some new ideas. Similarly, when you listen to Upanishadic classes, so you get to know some of the deliberations. Oh, their idea of soul is this, their idea of world is this, their idea of bhakti is this. So you get some clarity. Then, after that, you sit in solitude and you reason for yourself. You apply your reasoning, that is manana. And after that, whatever you have confirmed for yourself, please get it in your experience. You experience it. That is nididhyasana in meditation. So that's why receiving knowledge starts from shravana and matures in nididhyasana. So nididhyasana is actually realization. Realizing that, actualizing that, whatever you have known indirectly, now you get it as direct experience. That is possible in the meditation. And in this process, now we have to confirm for ourselves that who am I? The question and the answers according to the Yoga Vasishta. You contemplate on this. The mind has no form other than its functions like perception, knowledge, verbal knowledge, misapprehension, fiction, sleep, memory, cognition, etc. So this is mind. First, you understand all these functions of mind. Then, in the second stage, you contemplate on this. I am distinct from my thoughts and feelings. You contemplate on that. Like Buddha Bhagavan, he meditated 3 nights and got different experiences in 3 nights. All these are recorded in the Tripitaka Granthas. But the same experience of all the saints. I am not the mind, I am distinct, but I am the source of all thoughts. This is what Ramana Maharshi said. When somebody asked Ramana Maharshi, how to stop my thoughts? Then he said, you go for the source, you search it, then all the thoughts will stop. Then contemplate your true nature as I am consciousness. I am not what I think or feel. That means I am not the mind or intellect. I am pure energy. But this understanding is also with the help of mind. So that's why you are applying your mind and understanding. But when you get into deep state of meditation, then this also you cross over. And after transcending that, you remain as just consciousness, where your mind is totally emptied. And that is known as Chitta Nasha. And Chitta Nasha is twofold, Sarupa Nasha, Arupa Nasha. That means when you are liberated while being alive in the body, whatever mind emptiness is there, that is only Sarupa Chitta Nasha, because wherever necessary, he gets the mind active. But Arupa Chitta Nasha will be there after getting final liberation in the form of Videha Mukti. So that is the idea here. And ultimately, Yoga Vasishta wants to tell everybody that we are the reflection of the Supreme Consciousness, and we can raise ourselves to that level. And for that, whatever disturbances we are encountering, they should be understood as only appearances and illusions, and therefore they don't carry much value. And what carries value is only the consciousness that is the source of all universe. And me, the reflection of that Supreme Consciousness, not different from that, and that kind of contemplation only takes us to the final goal, Purushartha, as moksha, and we will be finally liberated. That's what Yoga Vasishtha says. And in the last chapter of Yoga Vasishtha, it actually concludes with the words of Bharadwaja and Vasishtha. There he says, "See, Sri Rama, I have told you all the states from Jivan Mukti to teaching between the disciple and the preceptor, the communication between these two. The proper thing should be communicated. It is not the individual. See, individuals are not important. The communication of knowledge, that is very important." And Bharadwaja gets satisfied. He says, "Wow, I have got wonderful knowledge today," he says. And he says, "Sri Rama, you remove all these, empty up your mind, and finally get to that final supreme level, supreme state of liberation," he says. So thus ends the Yoga Vasishtha in 6 chapters, 32,000 shlokas, and about 39 stories in 3 days. Thank you all. Yeah, thank you.